Welcome to NephroTube Nephrology Online Lectures. As we are discussing Oxford Handbook of Nephrology and Hypertension, the main core of the lecture is a discussion of Oxford Handbook of Nephrology and Hypertension. In this lecture, we will discuss acute kidney injury in sepsis. All our lectures as a PowerPoint are present on nephrotube.com. And the video recordings of these lectures in both Arabic and English languages are available at our YouTube channel, NephroTube. As it was mentioned in Oxford Handbook, that sepsis is common in ICU patients. And it is important to know that the patients who has renal failure and it is sepsis related, they have high mortality rate. And this concept is present in all AKI patients, whatever the etiology, that the incidence of morbidity and mortality increases in patients with acute kidney injury, but the percentage of the incidence differs according to the etiology. Patients with acute kidney injury secondary to renal failure has a high rate of mortality. We have three definitions: sepsis, sepsis syndrome, and septic shock, and we will talk about them later in the lecture. Okay. Causative organisms for sepsis: many organisms causing significant sepsis. Maybe the most common for the gram-positive is just Staphylococci, and the more common for gram-negative, both E. coli and Pseudomonas, and other microorganisms may cause sepsis as fungal parasites and viruses. How sepsis becomes shock? This is a general pathophysiology. It depends mainly on in short points. We will take this in short points, that the engulfed pathogen, if this is the pathogen and it is engulfed by our defense cells, it will be lysed, and this will lead to release of inflammatory mediators. And these inflammatory mediators also, and the fragments of the engulfed organism will be recognized by specific cell receptors like the toll-like receptors. Besides the pro-inflammatory mediators and the fragmented parts of the engulfed pathogen, the endothelium itself, the endothelial cell, will upregulate adhesion molecules like VCAM, ICAM, and also a large quantity of nitric oxide will be released that will cause vasodilatation in the arterial and systemic circulation. And finally, there is reduced microvascular flow, mitochondrial dysfunction, and all of these will lead to organ failure. This is just a short note about how sepsis becomes shock. How this will be translated clinically? As there is a large amount of nitric oxide, inflammatory mediators, how this will be reflected clinically. There will be decrease in systemic vascular resistance and vasodilatation of the systemic arterioles and vasodilatation of the capillaries due to the release of large amount of nitric oxide. And this will lead to decrease in blood pressure and also will lead to increase in capillary leakness, because if we suppose that this is the capillaries have endothelial layer with severe vasodilatation, the tight junction between the capillary cells and the pores between the capillary endothelial cells will be wide, and this will facilitate the leak from the intravascular compartment to the extravascular compartment, and increase capillary thickness and decrease in the intravascular volume, more hypoperfusion and hypotension in these patients. There will be local tissue injury due to the neutrophil recruitment and the inflammatory mediators. 1, 2, and 3, especially point 1 and 2, will activate the defensive mechanisms of the body, which are trying to increase the blood pressure and the blood volume again. So we will find in septic patients that there is increase in the sympathetic activity to induce vasoconstriction and increase in blood pressure, salt and water retention, also activation of renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system, and also there is an anosmotic release of ADH vasopressin. All of these are trying to correct the loss of the systemic vascular resistance and to correct the capillary leakage. And finally, an important point to know that the vascular smooth muscle of the blood vessels in this situation of sepsis become less sensitive to vasoconstrictors and less sensitive to the high adrenaline aldosterone ADH level. This is because of the presence of the inflammatory mediators that affect the normal physiology and response of the vascular smooth muscles. So, in short, sepsis means that there is pro-inflammatory mediators, dead fragments, increased number of nitric oxide that will lead to decrease in systemic vascular resistance, capillary leakage that will lead to activation of the defense mechanisms of the body as increased sympathetic nervous system, renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system, and vasopressin release. Okay. We are continuing our introduction about sepsis, the kidney in sepsis, how kidney may be affected in sepsis. In sepsis, there is decrease in kidney perfusion. As we said, that there is systemic loss of vascular resistance and the blood pressure, so this is important. The systemic loss of blood pressure, which will decrease the perfusion of the kidney, causing hypoxia of the kidney, will activate, as we said, noradrenaline release from the body, sympathetic activation in the body. Both noradrenaline and sympathetic activation, especially noradrenaline, will cause renal afferent arteriolar vasoconstriction and more renal hypoperfusion. So the first point, that noradrenaline in the body, and even the noradrenaline that we will give to our patient as a medication, as we will say later, will cause renal hypoperfusion. The second point, that it was found that although there is a high systemic nitric oxide formation, there is downregulation of intrarenal nitric oxide production. Nitric oxide is decreased within the kidney, which will lead to loss of vasodilatation within the kidney, more hypoperfusion of the renal tissue. And finally, as we said, the third point, that there is local coagulopathy with intraglomerular thrombus formation. Local coagulopathy increased because of the inflammatory mediators and disturbed homeostasis. This will lead to more decrease in capillary and kidney perfusion. So the end result of all these points and factors is hypoxia, decreased oxygen delivery of the kidney, and acute tubular necrosis. So the main pathology of kidney affection in septic patients related to sepsis itself is acute tubular injury. So it is logic to save the kidney is to cut this circuit. To cut this circuit, we have to correct the blood pressure. To correct the blood pressure, so there may be a role of vasopressor therapy, although it may have a disadvantage of more renal hypoperfusion. But this depends on some factors we will mention later. But the main idea to save the kidney is trying to maintain intravascular volume and to maintain blood pressure and to increase systemic vascular resistance. So there may be a role for vasopressor therapy in our patients. In Oxford Handbook, they mentioned the vasopressor therapy many times. This is the first time they mentioned the importance of vasopressor therapy. They said that vasopressor therapy will counteract the generalized vasodilatation and the sepsis-associated decreased vascular resistance. However, it is important to know that noradrenaline may potentiate acute kidney injury. So monitoring the dose, the volume replacement of the patient that we will say later is important to maintain the perfusion of the kidney. It is important to know the main condition of the patient is the condition related to hypovolemia mainly, or to only vasodilation and hypotension, because the role of noradrenaline depends on or differ according to is this sepsis induced vasodilatation or hypovolemia. If the main etiology or the main pathogenesis is vasodilatation, so vasopressor has a very important role. But if the etiology mainly is due to hypovolemia, vasopressor may induce more injury for the kidney because we make vasoconstriction on an empty vessel. So here, fluid replacement is important beside the vasopressor therapy. In general, yes, we use both fluid replacement as the vasopressor therapy in the management of sepsis. Usually we start with fluid therapy, as we will say later, but this is just a general concept as it was mentioned in Oxford Handbook, just a notification that the effect of noradrenaline mainly depends on the etiology of the renal hypoperfusion. Is it mainly due to vasodilatation or hypovolemia? If it is due to vasodilatation, so noradrenaline effect is better. If it is due to hypovolemia, it may decrease renal perfusion more, and here the fluid replacement is the main treatment. Okay, so the key point is that adequate fluid resuscitation must take place before vasopressor administration, as we said, to avoid the dilemma of what is etiology of the renal hypoperfusion in this patient, vasodilatation or hypovolemia. Okay. Now we finished an introduction written in this book about the main idea of the pathophysiology in sepsis and the main idea of the affection or of how the kidney is affected in sepsis. Then there are some definitions. We will go through them rapidly. We have a definition called systemic inflammatory response syndrome. The patient has infection with a temperature more than 38.5 or less than 36. Heart rate is increased, respiratory rate increased with low PCO2 due to hyperventilation, high white cell count, or even leukopenia. Another definition is sepsis. Sepsis is the same points or criteria of systemic inflammatory response and positive culture or focus of infection identified. Then we have what is called severe sepsis. It is sepsis and one of the following. All of the following mainly, or most of them mainly, document a target organ damage or effect, affection. Skin mottling, capillary refill more than 3 seconds, decreased urine output, accumulation of lactate, altered mental status, thrombocytopenia or DIC, ARDS or impaired cardiac function. This is called sepsis. And finally, septic shock is the severe sepsis definition beside decrease in the mean arterial blood pressure less than 60 millimeter mercury, although of fluid challenge or fluid resuscitation. Those are the main definitions in sepsis and septic shock. I have to comment here about the fluid. The fluid, the book will mention it different times, and I will collect what we need from it as information about the fluids in one or two slides. But here they mention that after resuscitation by sodium chloride or colloid. The word colloid here needs some clarification, not any type of colloid, and the start of management is not usually by colloid. We will mention this now. Okay, how to manage our patient? Septic shock bundle. Yes, sure, we have to make culture from blood and other sites. Then we have to start broad-spectrum antibiotics according to the suspected source of infection. We may start antiviral and antifungal according to the clinical scenario and according to the immune status of the patient. Further diagnostic measures should delay resuscitation. You have to start resuscitation. So the first point is to start antibiotics. Then you may need to give crystalloids and vasopressors. Again, as I said, they mentioned in the book crystalloids and the vasopressor many times, and we collect the important data about them in another slide later. So here the cornerstone are broad spectrum antibiotics. I will say fluid replacement, not colloid, not crystalloids, because we have to clarify some points about the type of fluid to be used and vasopressors. Those are the main important three points for the management of sepsis, for the management of sepsis itself, and for the protection of the kidney: broad spectrum antibiotics, fluid replacement, and vasopressors. Another points, mainly they are of the intensivist rule, the ICU physician, but we, as nephrologists, we have to know the targets and goals of most of them, because we are involved in the management of these cases. CVP, central venous pressure, must be more than 88 millimeter mercury, and central venous oxygen saturation must be more than 70%. If you cannot measure central venous oxygen saturation from superior vena cava, you can only measure the mixed venous oxygen saturation, and you need it to be more than 65%. If there is persistence of low central venous oxygen saturation or low mixed venous oxygen saturation, you may consider transfusion of packed red blood cell to achieve high hematocrit level, plus minus dobutamine. But mainly you may consider transfusion of packed red blood cells. We have two situations in septic patients, especially with acute kidney injury, that we have to consider transfusion. The first point to consider transfusion of packed red blood cells, if the patient is still hypoxic, with a central venous oxygen saturation less than 70%, or mixed venous oxygen saturation less than 65%. Okay, our target during the first 6 hours of resuscitation, to include all the following: CVP more than 8 millimeter mercury, mean arterial blood pressure more than 65 millimeter mercury, urine output more than 0.5 ml per kilogram per hour, and as we said, central venous oxygen saturation more than 70%, or the mixed venous oxygen saturation more than 65%. One of the most important points in septic patients and the ICU patients is to normalize serum lactate. Serum lactate is a marker for tissue hypoperfusion. More hypoperfusion equal more serum lactate. And I'll go out from the Oxford Handbook to mention some important points about lactic acidosis, because it is a critically an important point for nephrologists to know how to manage. In general, blood lactate is useful for screening, risk stratification, and the prognosis. And there is evidence that hyperlactinemia, even if it is relative, and even if the hyperlactinemia is within normal range, I mean that there is increase in lactate level, but within upper normal range, is related to hospital mortality in critically ill patients. Whatever the level of the lactate, with increasing level of lactate, there is increased incidence of mortality, even if the lactate level is within normal range. And it is suggested that all patients with a lactate at admission above 2.5 should be closely monitored for signs of deterioration, but patients with an even lower lactate level should be considered for serial lactate monitoring. And our target is to normalize serum lactate level. And the main management of normalization of serum lactate level is to treat the cause. So in our case, is to give antibiotics, and to the main important point to get lactate level with normal is fluid resuscitation. I have a lecture about lactate and the kidney from bedside to bedside, different types and etiologies of lactate with the management, different type of lactate acidosis, lactic acidosis with the management. We'll find the lecture on nephrotube.com to see this category in depth. Back to our lecture, we said that the most important points to treat septic patient till now: antibiotic therapy, fluid replacement, vasopressors. Then we talked about the targets regarding our CVP, oxygen saturation, and other targets, mean arterial blood pressure, urine output. And then we said that we have to normalize serum lactate and the importance of monitoring of serum lactate. And the main treatment of serum lactate is to get serum lactate within normal is fluid replacement. Again, the book mentioned again the fluid therapy. Here they said that you have given initial fluid challenge about minimum of 30 ml per kilogram in first 4 to 6 hours, and you have to continue fluid pulses as long as there is hemodynamic improvement. I have to go again through other evidence regarding what type of fluid you have to use in septic patients. The book said here that you have to start with crystalloids, and you have to consider adding albumin to initial fluid resuscitation if serum albumin is low. Okay, I have to go through some trials comparing which type of fluids you have to start with in septic patients and the critically ill patients. One of the most important trials in the comparison of the type of fluid to start for fluid resuscitation in intensive care unit patients is SAFE trial on about 7,000 patients. They give albumin or saline for patients with trauma, critically ill patients with trauma, severe sepsis, or ARDS. There was no difference between albumin as a resuscitation fluid or saline as a resuscitation fluid regarding any outcome of the study. Regarding duration of renal replacement therapy needed, duration of mechanical ventilation, length of stay in hospital, and length of stay in ICU. Even there is no difference between two types of fluid resuscitation regarding mortality. So it is logic to start by saline as the main resuscitation fluid, but I have to mention that I didn't finish my evidence. I will compare later saline with balanced crystalloids. But let us talk about which is better to start with in septic patients, saline or albumin. Another review article in Cochrane comparing crystalloids versus colloids, albumin versus crystalloids regarding the mortality in ICU patients as a starting type of fluid resuscitation. There was no difference between albumin and the crystalloid regarding death. That's why our KDIGO guidelines recommend to use isotonic crystalloids rather than colloids for any patient with risk of AKI or with AKI in absence of hemorrhagic shock, because sure, in hemorrhagic shock we will transfuse blood. But what is KDIGO missing? KDIGO missing that we may need to transfuse albumin for these patients. Yes, the main starting type of fluid resuscitation is crystalloids, but we may need albumin. In analysis of the SAFE trial, they found that patients with sepsis get benefit regarding relative risk of death if they had some albumin in their transfusion. And many trials and randomized controlled trials, it is a systematic review and meta-analysis of 17 randomized controlled trials found a benefit from albumin transfusion as a resuscitation fluid for patients with sepsis. And this is why Survivors Sepsis Campaign in 2012 and even the more recent edition of these guidelines show that yes, we have to start with crystalloids, as we said, by about 30 ml per kilogram. But a portion of this may be albumin equivalent, and if you will need to transfuse a large amount in severe sepsis and you need substantial amount of crystalloids, you may use albumin as a replacement or as an add-on for saline. And this is what KDIGO missing. Especially the albumin has effect especially in septic patients when the serum albumin was below than 2.5 and another trial below than 2. So as mentioned in Oxford, you may consider albumin as transfusion with there is low serum albumin. And I will add, you have to add albumin if you will resuscitate with a very large amount with saline. To conclude the albumin use in critically ill and septic patients, isotonic crystalloids, and I have to mention again, isotonic crystalloids or balanced crystalloids. I will mention the difference now. But in general, crystalloids is important for initial management for expansion of intravascular volume in patients at risk for AKI or with AKI. Albumin may be needed with when there is a requirement for substantial amounts of crystalloids, especially if there is low serum albumin below than 2 or 2.5. And I have a lecture on nephrotube.com about the albumin use in acute kidney injury, chronic kidney disease, and dialysis, when, why, and why, when, and how. So that is an old lecture, but mainly most of the evidence didn't change till now about the use of albumin in nephrology patients. I made a collection in this lecture about AKI in critically aseptic patients, hepatorenal, diuretic resistance, intradiuretic hypertension, therapeutic plasma exchange. You can check the lecture on nephrotube.com. Back to our lecture. We said till now the most important management in sepsis, antibiotics, fluid replacement, and we have mentioned the different types of fluid, although we will add on this now, different another types of fluid replacement. And we mentioned the targets of different parameters, SCVV, blood pressure, etc. Let's try to answer this case related to what we said till now. In short, this is a 32-year-old kidney transplant recipient evaluated in the emergency department for cough, fever, hypotension, febrile, temperature is 39, blood pressure is low, 95-60, heart rate is high, 110-120, decreased lung sounds, and egophony on the left base of the lung. No peripheral edema. Diuretic output is about 0.5 ml per kilogram per hour. The lab, there is nothing striking in the lab except that the total CO2 is 18, meaning that there is acidosis. And the creatinine raised from 0.9 to 1.1, it was 0.9 2 weeks ago. High leukocyte count, hemoglobin is 8.2. Chest radiograph shows left lower lobe infect. So this is a case with a chest infection. Low blood pressure, decreased urine output, high creatinine. So this is a case of chest infection, slightly, I mean, not say choked, but decreased renal perfusion and low blood pressure and acute kidney injury. The question is, in addition to appropriate targeted antibiotic regimen, which one of the following is the most appropriate initial management for this patient? I will give you 15 seconds to choose the correct answer. Yes, the answer is D. You have to give intravenous, as we said, isotonic crystalloid and or albumin. It's better, not and or, but it is the most accurate. Crystalloids plus or minus albumin, yes, not and or. According to her hemodynamic status, with addition of vasopressor if unresponsive to fluids or albumin. Okay, point A, yes, is true. Also, but this is more accurate because they added the vasopressor option. Intravenous vasopressor is not the first goal or start of management. The first start of management, the starting of the management is mainly by fluids. Transfusion of back red blood cells, no, because here hemoglobin is 8.2. And there is no evidence in the case that there is hypoxia or decreased oxygen saturation. So point C is not considered to be normal. Okay, back to our management. We talked about the fluid and its type, and we said when to consider albumin, mainly if serum albumin is low, especially if it below 2.52. One of the most important points in the management, and one of the most important points of malpractice in management of ICU patients, is the using or the usage of bicarbonate. You have to avoid, yes, the patient is acidosis, but it is lactic acidosis. You have to avoid sodium bicarbonate therapy for the correction of hypoperfusion-induced lactic acidemia. if the patient pH is more than 7.15. But I have a consideration about pH more than 7.15. It differs. We may use it if the pH below 7.1 or below 7.2. 7.50 is an average. I will show now what I mean. But we have to mention now a general rule. It's better to avoid sodium bicarbonate if there is no evidence of severe acidosis in this patient. Go out of Oxford handbook. You have to consider bicarbonate for the treatment of lactic acidosis if the pH is less than 7.1 or at least less than 7.2 in the presence of underlying cardiovascular disease of evidence or hemodynamic instability. So this is the most common presentation we see, a patient with hemodynamic instability. So you have to start serum bicarbonate when the pH is below than 7.2, especially if the serum bicarbonate is below than 20. Why not to start serum bicarbonate if the pH is more than 7.2? If you started serum bicarbonate when the pH is more than 7.2, you will get negative benefit. You will get bad effect. But if you started bicarbonate in patients with serum bicarbonate below than 7.2, you will get a benefit, as I will show you later. Why not to start serum bicarbonate when pH is more than 7.2? This is because sodium bicarbonate have many negative effects. Whatever the possible mechanism of these effects, it was found that serum bicarbonate may cause vasodilatation, decreased cardiac output, decreased PO2, and intracellular acidosis, which will affect intracellular homeostasis. So at the theoretical level, sodium bicarbonate has negative effect. Also, multiple randomized controlled trials tested the use of serum bicarbonate in the management of lactic acidosis with high pH, and they found that the use of sodium bicarbonate in the setting of lactic acidosis failed to significantly improve hemodynamic status in humans. Even there is an evidence in a recent published trial, systematic review, that bicarbonate may increase the all-cause mortality and, yes, sure, risk of hypocalcemia in critically ill patients. So it is better to avoid sodium bicarbonate when pH is more than 7.2, but use serum bicarbonate with low pH to correct severe acidosis. Let's see this case. 63-year-old kidney transplant recipient, stage 2 acute kidney injury, urosepsis. She received 4 liters of Ringer's lactate, and again, I will mention the balancing crystalloids and their importance in the management of sepsis and septic-induced and in critically ill patients later. Okay, she remains intubated and ventilated, although of the fluid replacement. So they decided to support her with norepinephrine and vasopressin. The striking in her investigation that she is acidotic, and there is increase in the serum creatinine 2.6 from baseline 1.1. Her pH is 7.17, is less than 7.2. There is decrease in PCO2 as a compensation. So she has acidosis, acute kidney injury, and shock. The physician recommended infusion of sodium bicarbonate to achieve an arterial pH 7.3. The question is, in this setting, administration of bicarbonate will be associated with one of the following. To decide if the bicarbonate is beneficial to the patient or not, we have to check the pH. The pH here is 7.17. If the pH was more than 7.2, so bicarbonate will be harmful. But because pH here is below 7.2, so you will get a benefit from bicarbonate, and there will be decreased risk of progressive AKI requiring dialysis. And the evidence said that in ICU patients with a pH less than 7.2, low PCO2, and serum bicarbonate less than 20, who received sodium bicarbonate to achieve or to increase the arterial pH to 7.3, will have decreased rate of acute kidney injury, requiring renal replacement therapy, improved mortality at 28 days, lower rates of hyperkalemia, but will have a negative effect as higher incidence of metabolic acidosis, hypernatremia, and hypocalcemia. But the benefit that I will get is more than the risk I will may have. Okay, how to give bicarbonate? This is an equation that you may use to replace or to calculate the bicarbonate deficit for these patients. And we have many applications on mobile applications to calculate the bicarbonate deficit. You have to replace only 50% of the bicarbonate deficit you calculated at the start, because we know that all equations we use for corrections, even if it is for other parameters as sodium, calcium, all of these are just estimations. So you have to replace slowly, and you have to monitor the lab investigation of the patient. So here it is suggested to start with replacement on only 50% of the dose you calculated. The infusion of the bicarbonate is about 0.1 ml equivalent per kilogram per minute. They suggest here to use isoosmotic bicarbonate. Though the trials I mentioned above, they used here 4.2 hypertonic sodium bicarbonate. Okay. Consider administration of calcium intravenously to prevent fall in calcium after base treatment, because we all know that sodium bicarbonate may induce some alkalosis and hypocalcemia. So we covered till now the most important points: saline versus albumin, bicarbonate to use or not use, when to transfuse blood to this patient, and we covered the most important target point parameters for the patient: CVB, mean arterial blood pressure, oxygen saturation. Vasopressor, the target to use vasopressor in this patient. As I said to you, the handbook mentioned vasopressor many times. Here they collected all the data you need for vasopressor therapy. Target blood pressure initially, mean arterial blood pressure more than 65 millimeter mercury. Noradrenaline is first line. Adrenaline may be a substitution. Usually vasopressor use in the job of the intensivist. We here just enumerate the name of drugs. Dopamine is an alternative, okay, but don't use low dose dopamine for renal protection. Dopamine renal dose, don't use it for protection or for induction of diuresis. And the use of dopamine low dose will be mentioned in one of our next lectures. You may need inotropic therapy as dobutamine if there is myocardial dysfunction or there is ongoing signs of hyperperfusion despite adequate intravascular volume. Mainly, the use of vasopressor therapy and inotropes are the job of the intensivist. Again, corticosteroids may have a role in sepsis. I will not go through this. As we said, blood product administration has an important role if the patient saturation in the central veins is less than 70, or in the mixed venous blood when it is less than 65%. There's an important target for hemoglobin in these patients, septic patients, and below it we have to start blood transfusion. The target of blood hemoglobin level in these patients is more than 7 gram per deciliter. So you are not in need to start a blood transfusion in these patients if hemoglobin is more than 7. Why? Because I will show now in this case, if you transfused blood for patient with hemoglobin more than 7, this may increase the risk of some parameters in these patients. This is a patient in ICU with acquired pneumonia, shocked, on mechanical ventilator, vasopressors, with mean arterial blood pressure more than 65. The hemoglobin dropped from 9.8 to 7.9, but there is no evidence of active bleeding, because if there is an evidence of active bleeding, it's sure I have to replace this blood loss. So now, what is the most likely outcome when using a transfusion threshold of hemoglobin below 9 and below 7? What if I transfused now, making the target of my hemoglobin 7, in comparison to the target what I mentioned, 7. What if I transfuse now, making target hemoglobin 9 in comparison to making the target of hemoglobin 7. If I transfuse now and the patient hemoglobin 7.9, what will be the most likely outcome? Improved survival, decreased risk of AKI, decreased duration of mechanical intubation, increased risk of acute kidney injury, decreased requirement of vasoactive surgery. If you transfuse blood in the absence of desaturation and in the absence of blood loss, and when the hemoglobin is more than 7, this may increase the risk for acute lung injury. So avoid transfusion when hemoglobin is more than 7 gram per deciliter. Okay. You are not in need to administer fresh frozen plasma to correct laboratory clotting abnormalities unless there is bleeding or there is a planned invasive procedure. Antithrombin has no role now. Consider platelet administration if platelet count is below than 5,000 regardless bleeding, or if the platelet count is between 5,000 and 30,000 and there is a increased risk of bleeding. And if there is invasive surgery or invasive procedure and there is a low count of platelet, because counts of platelet more than 50,000 are recommended for surgery or invasive procedures. Okay, let's continue the most important points for the management and support of septic patients, especially with acute kidney injury. Glucose control. Oxford Handbook mentioned that you have to start insulin if the patient blood glucose level is more than 180, and your target is to start and monitor your patient every 1 to 2 hours till you reach your target goal below than 180, and then you have to monitor blood glucose level at least every 4 hours. But the target of KDIGO guidelines is less regarding the blood glucose control. The target of the Oxford Handbook is less than 180, but the target mentioned in KDIGO guidelines is between 110 and 140 line to prevent hyperglycemia and hypoglycemia in these patients. Renal priorities in the ICU. What are the main points you have to put in mind for your renal patients? You have to maintain independent renal function. There is a point here where that we have to explain more. They said that no convincing data to suggest any particular volume expander. No, I have an exclamation mark on this point. I will mention now. Or vasopressor is better or worse for the kidneys. There is an evidence that there is no difference between vasopressin and noradrenaline, ADH and noradrenaline as a vasopressor therapy, but there is a little evidence that patients on noradrenaline may have more increased need for renal replacement therapy. Okay. Back to this point. They said that no convinced data to suggest any particular volume expander. Although balanced crystalloid solutions are increasingly common, and we have to stop at this point. We mentioned before the comparison between saline and albumin as volume expanders. And we said that there is no difference between saline and albumin, so it is better to start by saline. Except if the patient is septic with severe hypoalbuminemia, it's better to add on albumin besides saline, especially if you will use large volume of saline. Here, there is an important point. Now we will compare saline with balanced crystalloids. They said in the book here that balanced crystalloid solutions are increasingly recommended. And later, after the publishment of the book, this AMEGA trial in 2018, March 2018, published in New England Journal of Medicine, comparing balanced crystalloids versus saline in critically ill patients as a fluid resuscitation. The study was on about 16,000 adults. They received either saline or balanced crystalloid in the form of Ringer's lactate solution or plasma light A. The results showed that Among critically ill patients, the use of balanced crystalloids for intravenous fluid administration resulted in lower rate of the composite outcome of death from any cause, lower rate of new renal replacement therapy, and lower rate of persistent renal dysfunction. So they showed that balanced crystalloids are better than saline as a resuscitative fluid. So if I will put in order the resuscitative fluids in ICU patients, critically ill patients, I will put number one, balanced crystalloids, followed by saline, and plus or minus albumin according to the need and according to the patient condition and serum albumin. Some literature mentioned that if the patient is hyperkalemic and you will use balanced crystalloid linear lactate in a large volume, you may avoid balanced crystalloid if the patient has hyperkalemia. So using balanced crystalloids in patients with hyperkalemia may be dangerous if you will use a very large amount of balanced crystalloids. Very small amounts may not affect the serum potassium level, but large amounts will affect sure serum potassium level. But yes, sure, you will manage the hyperkalemia of these patients within a short time as possible, and you can use at this time balanced crystalloids. One of the fluids that may be used theoretically as a volume resuscitation is the hydroxyethyl starch or the HETA starch. Logic to be used as it is, as it may increase the osmotic pressure and maintain intravascular volume. But no, don't use it, because it will increase the acute kidney injury. HETA starch and all fluids of this type will increase acute kidney injury in these patients. It causes kidney injury. The only resuscitative fluids are balanced crystalloids, isotonic saline, plus or minus albumin. HETA starch and all other types of these fluids will induce and increase kidney injury and acute kidney injury. Let's see this case. 70-year-old woman is hospitalized for urinary sepsis, resuscitated by 6 liters of fluids. On the basis of published retrospective cohort studies, resuscitation with one of the following types of intravenous fluids is least likely to be associated with the development of AKI in this patient. The answer is isotonic balanced head electrolyte solution, not saline. Saline is number two. And not hydroxylic starch, because hydroxylic starch will increase the incidence of acute kidney injury. Okay, as we said before, and we say again, and we mention it later in page 144, avoid the dose dopamine. And finally, you may need to dialyze your patient, and I will leave this part to be discussed in depth in our next lecture, renal replacement in acute kidney injury in deep details. Let's have a quiz, test yourself, 3 cases to clarify the most important point we mentioned in our lecture. Case 1, 38-year-old male kidney transplant recipient in the emergency department for fever, cough, and malaise. Fever 38.9, blood pressure is 115/50, tachycardia, respiratory rate is 22, crackles at the left lung base, allograft is not tender. The striking of the investigation that leukocyte count is high, hemoglobin is 13.2, total CO2 is 20, so there is acidosis. Creatinine increased to 1.4 from baseline 0.8. Glucose is within target 96. pH is 7.4 with low PCO2 and low serum bicarbonate, and lactate with a range of 1.3. We diagnose lactic acidosis when the lactate level is more than 4. Urine analysis, no significant findings. Urine sediments, no significant findings. Chest radiograph shows dense left lower lobe infiltrate. Your colleague in emergency department asks you asks for your advice regarding the most appropriate initial choice of fluid management for these patients. I will give you 15 seconds to answer this question. Yes, the answer is normal saline or balanced buffered solution. This is the most accurate. Hitostorch, we said that we don't like it because it increased acute kidney injury. Isoncotic albumin is not that best first option, especially that there is no mention in the case of the serum level of the patient. And I didn't start saline yet or balanced crystalloids. And finally, the best initial option is isotonic albumin. Does balanced buffer solution? No, albumin is not the first choice in this case. So the correct answer is B. Second case, 75-year-old man, hypertension, presents with urosepsis, he's shot. Blood pressure 7845. CVB is 3 mm mercury, our target. He received Ringer's lactate and hitostarch for volume resuscitation. Which one of the following statements is correct? I will give you another 15 seconds. Yes, hitostarch should be avoided in patients with sepsis because its use is associated with increased incidence of AKI. Let's check other points. Treatment with Ringer lactates, lactated Ringer, and hitostarch is critically component of early. No, hitostarch is not recommended. Patient should receive intravenous fluid until reach CVB target of 6 to 8. No, our target is more than 8. Albumin 4% should be used in place of Ringer's lactate. No, our first line of management is not albumin. The first line of management is balanced crystalloid. Our final case, this is 66-year-old man, urosepsis, ventilatory support, blood pressure is low, pulse is high, lungs show coarse breath sounds anteriorly, no leg edema, creatinine is high, leukocyte count is high, hemoglobin is 8.6, lactate is high, he has lactic acidosis usually. Kidney ultrasound shows no hydronephrosis. Which one of the following interventions has the greatest potential to favorably affect this patient's survival? Take your time. Yes, the answer is timely antibiotics and fluid resuscitation. The main management of this case. Let's check other points. Central venous pressure and venous oxygen monitoring via central venous catheter, central venous oxygen monitoring. Yes, this is one of our targets, but this is not the initial important first line of management. Point E is the most important, then point A will come next. Okay, transfusion to hemoglobin more than 10. No, we said we don't need to transfuse as the hemoglobin is more than 7 and the saturation is more than 70% centrally or 65% peripherally, dovitamine, no, it is not as a first line of management. Thank you for your watching. You'll find this lecture and the other lectures recorded in both Arabic and English languages on our YouTube channel. And you'll find all PowerPoint of our webinar lectures and more lectures on nephrotube.com. And join our Facebook group for the announcements of next webinars. See you later and thank you.